Hello, it's Philip Taylor speaking from Richmond Green Chambers in London. This morning I'm looking at a book which has come to us from Edward Elgar Publishing Limited. They're a family business and they specialise in particular in very high quality, well-argued academic papers in the form of books, sometimes collections and sometimes individual statements of detail in particular areas of international law. They also specialise very much in intellectual property, which is a fascinating area in its own right. Obviously, it has the global dimension. And in this case, they have produced an excellent book, which I'm reviewing this morning. It's this book up here. It's got a long title. It's called The South China Sea Disputes and the Law of the Sea. Very interesting area of law, and I'm going to develop that theme in a minute. It's been edited by three people. I hope I pronounced these names correctly. S. Jayakumar, Tommy Koch, and Robert Beckman. And this is part of the NUS Centre for International Law, published by Edward Elgar. My wife Elizabeth and I have discussed the book, and we've written a review. We gave it the title, For Practitioners and Policymakers, Objective Views on Dispute Management in the South China Sea. Now you can see immediately we're looking at management, we're looking at disputes in the sea, and we're looking at the way in which perhaps they're going to be dealt with. Before I go into the review, let me show you the book, because it's an interesting one. As I say, it's very much part of the stable of books from Edward Elgar. There's the front spine. Then the back, you can see the back, it's got a little bit of detail concerning what's actually in this book itself. And as I say, it's an interesting book in its own right. It's not very big, 260 odd pages. There's the index right at the back, show you a bit more of it. You've got a structure, you've got conclusions right at the back, which are always very helpful. As I said, what you have got here, you've got a lot of footnoting. You can see that mentioned there. You've got Roman numerals for the subheads that they run through. I'll just go a little bit further into it. Let me give you an example here of chapter 6. There we go. There's chapter 6 itself. It says, do the coastal states in the South China Sea have a continental shelf beyond 200 nautical miles? And then you've got obviously a structure of introduction, the middle bit and then the end bit. And it explains who the author is and explains where the actual article has come from. Now at the front you've got the main front chapter, the editing by the three main people. And there's a note about the NUS Centre for International Law, which is there in case you want to know any more about that particular centre. Then you've got the contents. You can see there are eight main chapters, then the index. You've got an introduction. You've actually got some figures, first of all. Let me deal with those first. You've got a statement about who the editors are. They're very experienced people. Then you've got a list of the contributors, very much part of how Edward Elgar produced this. There are quite a lot of them. These gentlemen here, then people here, and then you can see some at the end. Then there's some acknowledgements about where they've got information from. A nice little map showing the area on the planet. Then we launch actually into the introduction itself by the editors about what this book is about. So the South China Sea has long been a source of tension and potential conflict in the Asia Pacific region. So that's your start off point, and you can see immediately where they're going to. Then we go straight into the first chapter. So as I say, it's a detailed book, it's a fascinating book. It's not an area that I've been to myself, but it's certainly an area that I think holds a lot of interest for us, because it's not just about the area itself, it's about the principles that are at stake. And that's really when I'm going to come into the book itself. Because as the latest title in the Elgar NUS Centre for International Law series says, this is an important book for both international and maritime lawyers, especially those who work or their interests involve events or concerns in the Asia Pacific region, specifically the South China Sea. And the book certainly sheds considerable light, not to mention enlightenment, on the underlying sources of tension and potential conflict in that region, namely ongoing and intractable territorial disputes over a number of islands claimed variously by, for example, Brunei, Darussalam, China, Taiwan, the Philippines, and Vietnam. Can these disputes ever be resolved? Big question, because this isn't just one area where there are disputes, they're all over the place. And the law of the sea, we've had conventions, we have all sorts of things, not really been able to deal with it. So we've got asked the question, apparently, according to the prevailing opinion among scholars and academics and officials, is no. Instead, the solution, practical and pragmatic rather than permanent, centres not so much on resolving such disputes, but of managing potential conflicts. And that's, I think, the key phrase, managing potential conflicts, with a view to, in the words of the editors, setting aside disputes and pursuing joint development and other cooperative arrangements. Well, you know what that means in reality. It's a form of fudge. But what it does mean is that instead of having the continuing hassle and disputes where you know you're never going to get a result, what you do is you then try to manage it and make the best out of what is a bit of a messy business. And that's not just about the South China Sea, it's about everywhere where there are disputes, and there are a lot across the globe. So what is particularly noteworthy about this book is the high level of expertise and informed experience that the three editors and their team of contributors have brought to its publication. As professor and chairman of the International Advisory Panel of the Center for International Law, S. Jayakumar's long list of credentials includes service as Singapore's former deputy PM, senior minister, and other prominent ministerial roles. Tommy Cock is professor and chairman of the governing board of the Center for International Law, and Robert Beckman is an associate professor and director of the Center for International Law at the National University of Singapore. All have had extensive experience in consultancy and negotiation on South China Sea issues. So they come to this with a lot of knowledge. Their overall objective, and that of the other expert contributors, is to present a detailed, unbiased analysis and comprehensive overview of the legal issues pertaining to the disputes over maritime claims, focusing on the links and overlaps between them. The individual chapters are based on papers originally presented at a roundtable conference on the South China Sea conducted in Singapore in June 2013. Scholarly and thorough, yet eminently readable, this book offers up important lessons and possibly paradigms for the management of cross-border or international disputes on territory, access to resources and other challenges to long-established maritime legal principles, notably freedom of navigation. And as I've said, it's not just about this area of the world. There are other disputes, and I'm sure you know what I'm referring to. Policymakers and government officials, as well as practitioners and academics with concerns about this potentially volatile region, should definitely read the insightful and up-to-date material presented conveniently in this book. And the law is stated as a publication date at 2014. So it's pretty up-to-date and very interesting as a book to read. Obviously, it's of a high academic standard. You can see from just the content, just opening it in the middle, you can see there's a lot of detail here. But it does make an interesting read, apart from anything else. And as I've said before, you look at the role of the United Nations and things like the Law of the Sea Conference, and then you realise that while we're trying to move ahead and be constructive, the difficulty really is always going to be that when you cannot get a resolution to a dispute. In fact, you know, we have alternative dispute resolution, ADR. But this is not going to be that. It's going to be alternative dispute management, because you're never going to get that final decision as to who owns what. because there will always be the row, saying someone saying I have that and it's mine, and another country saying the same thing. So what you've got to do is have some sort of management to effectively avoid a major conflict. And that's really what this book is, a blueprint to set out, if you like, giving as an example the